It's a Potemkin economy, and a Potemkin village, of course, is a village that's just a bunch of fake faux storefronts that are stood up so a ruler can float down a river and look upon all the wonderful villages that they are overseeing in their fine land. This has been the best fake recovery money can buy. There's going to be disruptions. There's going to be an economic crisis, if not collapse, depending on how bad things get. So, what do you do?
Hey guys, SGT here. Thanks so much for pushing play. We really appreciate you tuning in for this one. It's going to be a good one. We have Chris Martinson on the line. Of course, you guys know Chris from peakprosperity.com. You also know his work as an author from his last book, Crash Course. He's got a new book out that we're going to talk about a little bit on this call, and that one's called Prosper: How to Prepare for the Future and Create a World Worth Inheriting. Chris and I have an awful lot to talk about. Chris, welcome. First of all, I want to thank you for joining me. I think the last time we spoke was well over a year, probably 2 years ago. And at that point, oil was around $100 or more a barrel. Boy, has the world changed since. How are you?
It has changed, Sean. It's good to be back with you and looking forward to this.
Well, I'm really looking forward to it as well, Chris. And I just want to mention that your co-author is Adam Taggart, who could not join us here today. I want to ask you about the global economic turmoil that we're seeing right now. What's happening today is shaping up to be far worse than even what we saw in 2008, because all that happened after 2008, as you know, Chris, is they just covered up all the problems with paper. Today, the meltdown is global. Adding to the mix the deflation monster, the derivatives bubble, and endless fiat printing around the world, and the unsustainably low oil price, and we have the recipe for a true catastrophe. Now, Bill Holter, Andy Hoffman, and Rob Kirby are among just several people we've recently interviewed who all say this is the end, that the entire Federal Reserve fiat banking system and potentially the entire global economic system is unraveling before our eyes. Chris, is it really that bad?
Well, it's always possible, Sean. I do believe that the banks have more tricks up their sleeves. You know, I'm not among those who think that they're just going to fumble the ball and lose it all at once. I think this is going to be a long process. I think people should be prepared for some kind of outstanding crisis. Always possible. 2008 saw us get within a few hours of a potential systemic banking meltdown and failure. Obviously, that would create a lot of disruption. I think people obviously should be prepared for that. It's not the only thing they should be prepared for, though. This might be more of a marathon than a sprint, and they should be prepared for that as well. And those are harder to survive. You know, it's been six, now seven long years of the central banks pumping up asset prices and inflating the stock market and driving the bonds to yields nobody alive has ever seen before. And all that craziness is coming to an end. You know, this is going to be a big period of disruption. But, you know, it would be easier, instead of asking me where is the trouble in the world, if you ask me where there isn't trouble in the world, because there's just so few places to look at right now, whether it's Latin America, emerging markets more generally, whether it's Africa, Europe, China, even the United States, the core of the so-called healthy economy, economies of the world. Everybody's in trouble now. And, of course, they are for reasons that we've been talking about at Peak Prosperity, and you've been talking about at the SGT report, which is really that you can't print your way to prosperity. We tried, but the central banks put tens of trillions of dollars into the markets. And they went out, it flooded across the globe, did what appeared to be heroically awesome, tasty things on the way out the door, made emerging markets leaders feel like kings and gods and goddesses, and now that flood tide is receding. And it's doing the opposite, vicious part of the cycle on the way out, and it's absolutely crushing places. So, you know, look no further than Venezuela to see what happens when you have a complete failure of your political, economic, and financial systems at the same time. They do tend to go hand in hand. Or take a peek at what's going on in Greece right now, or in South Africa, or even Hong Kong. I mean, every place I'm tracking right now says danger, Will Robinson, warning signs, and I don't know how anybody can avoid it at this point.
Yeah, it's really getting scary for those of us that are paying attention, and even for those who aren't paying attention. A lot of the people out there, Chris, that have drank the Fed Kool-Aid or the CNBC Kool-Aid and think that the economy has done well and think that unemployment is really only around 5.5% are surprised now by these pink slips. You just wrote an article recently, Mass Layoffs to Return with a Vengeance. We've already seen them returning. We're seeing people, you know, we're seeing these companies lay off 2, 3,000, 10,000 people at a time. It's getting really scary for the common man. What do you make of the state of the U.S. economy right now? How bad is it really?
it's a Potemkin economy, and a Potemkin village, of course, is a village that's just a bunch of fake faux storefronts that are stood up so a ruler can float down a river and look upon all those wonderful villages that they are overseeing in their fine land. This has been the best fake recovery money can buy, and a lot of people get their clues, Sean, from the stock market. You know, as long as we were hitting new highs and, hey, Apple stock's at this price or Amazon's there or whatever, they're getting their clues from that, thinking that that means things are okay. But all you have to do is just peel back the covers on what's really been driving stock prices up, and it's been an ugly combination of things that don't say we've got a healthy recovery anywhere in the future. And those things are just the amount of money that's been thrown into speculation and allowing markets to go up. But secondarily was corporations looking at the 0% fictitious rate set by the Fed and saying, hey, 0%, I'll borrow at 1, and I'll retire stocks that are paying 2% dividends. That makes all the financial sense in the world from a CFO perspective. Mm-hmm. It drives the stock price up, so the CEO loves it. And all the holders of that stock are like, yeah, my price, you know, went up. I love this. But when you look under the surface, you find that corporations are holding more debt than they've ever held on that, and they went into debt to buy their shares back, which made the shares look good, made everybody feel good. But what did they not do? They did not invest in property, plant, and equipment. They didn't put it into employees. They preferentially hired low-wage employees while firing higher-wage employees. And, of course, all of that combines to what you're saying. The common man has easily discovered this and has said, this doesn't feel right to me. And, of course, the elites are all confused by this because, you know, they're like, why are the people so angry? I don't get it, you know. And the reason is that, and no secret here, all of these fictitious gains actually meant real money got pumped into real hands, and it went almost entirely to a very, very tiny upper crust of elites. Everybody else has been experiencing the opposite of that. Anybody listening to this who's in my shoes, which is decidedly middle class, knows that Obamacare made my cost of insurance go up, the cost of health care is up a lot, the cost of food is obviously up a lot, the cost of property taxes has never gone down. It only goes up in my neck of the woods, and so on and so forth. So that's what we're living under. The reality is the middle class, and by that I can include anybody from in the bottom 90% at this point, just getting squeezed, and being told everything's great. That's not a recipe for happy people.
No, it's high time people grab their pitchforks and start to hold the enemies of humanity accountable, which include the central banks. What about this deflation monster? Because you mentioned inflation in healthcare, in food, in real items that the common man needs to purchase every single day in order to survive. Meanwhile, we see this deflationary monster that has everybody so concerned. At what point does this deflation that we hear so often talked about and that everybody's so afraid of cause everything else to fall apart? Meaning everything's contingent on this giant stock market bubble. So if deflation is happening, it seems to me that the stock market bubble has to pop. And when it pops, does the rest of this Ponzi economy pop along with it?
It does. Let me get my definition of these terms in here. So by the time we see rising or falling prices, those are the effects. What's really happening, for when I say inflation or deflation, inflation happens when money and credit are expanding above a certain rate, and deflation happens when money and credit are falling below a certain rate. And so you look at 2008, that's one of the first times in the entire data series for credit going back decades that we saw credit actually begin to shrink. It was going backwards, mostly from the financial sector. Student loans weren't going down, government debt wasn't going down, households were deleveraging very minorly, but what was happening was the shadow banking system was not borrowing a bunch of money to go out and do whatever goofy things they were doing, like, you know, purchasing and selling credit default swaps and speculating on carry trades and all the funny things they like to do at that end. But all it took, Sean, for the entire system to practically come apart at the seams was for credit to go backwards a little bit. And then that one thing leads to another, the ball clunks down the stairs, and we eventually detect that in lower prices. We saw it in lower prices for houses and certain discretionary items, but not everything, right? Healthcare never went back in price. So inflation and deflation is never a complete process where everything goes up in price or everything goes down. It's murkier than that. But all you have to focus on is this. Is credit expanding or contracting. If credit's expanding, the system is stable, relatively speaking. If it's contracting, the system literally falls apart. Mm-hmm. And that's the unfortunate reality. You know, whether I'm going to put pros and cons and judge that and say it's good or bad, let me just say that's how the system works. It's either expanding or collapsing. And that's what the authorities are afraid of. And when I talk about the deflation monster, what I'm watching is that the opportunities for credit creation are shrinking. Fewer loans are being made. They're going to negative rates under the theory that banks, if punished to hold money on their balance sheets, will instead just do anything they can to loan that out. That's what the central banks are trying to do, is create more and more and more loans. The problem is you have to wander over to Main Street and onto corporations, lawns, and ask a few questions, and you discover that people aren't really in a borrowing mood. We don't get the narrative. We don't understand what the next big thing is we're supposed to be investing in, and people aren't borrowing nearly as much as they used to. And so that's the problem. And I got to tell you, if the deflation monster really catches hold, it is an ugly, ugly place. Notice that from 2007 to current, global debt went up by about $60 trillion in just that span of time, thanks to the central banks forcing that credit out the window, thanks to the private public sector picking up from the private sector and borrowing like crazy. So governments stuffed huge amounts of debts on their books, United States at the top of that heap, on and on. That story, if that ends, that deflation monster takes over, all of that gets undone and a little more. And I'm saying that if the deflation monster really rips on the landscape, we're going to look at losses that are measured in the tens, if not approaching $100 trillion of wipeout from both combined bond and equity markets in the world.
Yeah, well, this is a perfect segue then to ask you about derivatives. In your educated opinion, how bad is it, or how bad could it get, given everything you've just said, in the shadow banking system, you know, what's going on behind the scenes with derivatives? And I'm going to cite one example. And when I say this figure, I almost feel like I need to Google it and make sure I'm not misspeaking, because it's so huge. But I think Deutsche Bank's derivatives exposure is somewhere in the neighborhood of $50 trillion or more. And we've been seeing all week here discussion that Deutsche Bank is in the process of some sort of collapse as contagion spreads. And I'm going to quote here, Deutsche Bank's credit default swaps continue to push higher, smashing European bank risk to its highest level since 2013. And it goes on and on and on to talk about some really scary things happening at Deutsche Bank. What do you make of derivatives, and how bad could it get in the banking system, based on all these other things you've just cited without even having mentioned derivatives?
Oh, it could get very, very ugly. And here's why. So derivatives, fancy word, but a derivative is a bet, right? You and I could come up with a derivative. We could decide that we're going to bet, attach $10 million of value to whether a buoy sitting in the North Atlantic is going to record wave heights above or below a certain level at a certain time in the future. Mm-hmm. I mean, a derivative is just a bet. Mm-hmm. But the banks have written massive quantities of these things, measuring in the tens of trillions of dollars. You mentioned Deutsche Banks, but you could look at Citi, J.P. Morgan, Wells, those people here also writing in the tens of trillions of dollars of these things. And the problem with these derivatives is that, you know, if you and I wrote a derivative with each other, then we would probably be protecting some asset. So here's a derivative. I might want to buy the tasty, high-yielding, relatively speaking, 10-year debt of Greece. But I'm a little worried that Greece might default, and so you would sell me insurance on that, and that would be, you would be insuring me against the default of Greece's debts. And so they call that a credit default swap, right? And the problem with this is that I bought this insurance from you, and I feel like my $10 million of exposure to Greece's debt is been minimized. It's been eliminated. I have an insurance policy. So I win because I collect all this tasty interest, but if I lose and they default, you pay me, I'm whole. So I'm good, right? The problem comes in when there's tens of trillions, if not hundreds of trillions, of dollars of these sorts of insurance products out there, and something goes seriously wrong. At that point, I may well discover that you're not good for the $10 million because you weren't really expecting that to happen, and maybe you wrote too many of these, which is what happened to AIG in 2008. They just wrote opposite of these things. Yep. So all of a sudden, you can't pay me, but I was counting on that. And next thing I know, I have somebody breathing down my neck because I owe them, and this whole thing just sort of goes off in a chain. So we know derivatives have the potential to be a really bad, bad moment because so many people have mistakenly assumed that their risk has been insured away. And it hasn't been, not for a big event. We're pretty clear that that's what's going to happen in a big event. They're not actually going to pay off when you need them to. But we know the banks are really scared about them, and here's how we know. The G20 got together. They were discussing these bail-in provisions about how they were going to use depositor money and other monies inside the bank to get a bank out of trouble when it gets in trouble. And they enshrined in that language in the United States in what's called the Citi Amendment that was attached to a really stupid funding bill a while ago. The Citi Amendment, not actually called that, but that's what everybody called it. What that did was enshrined the right of derivative losses that any bank might incur to be senior to a bunch of other claims, including depositors. So mm-hmm. if you have your money in a big bank and they get in derivative trouble, those derivative losses, which are bets, will be paid out before you get your money back as a depositor.
So you're standing in line as a creditor.
Yes.
You can't get your cash. They keep your cash. They pay off their banking buddies. And you're standing in line as a creditor. People need to understand that, Chris. The money you have in banks right now, in your even in your savings account, money market accounts, savings accounts, checking accounts, you're a creditor if these banks go down.
You are, and worse, you're an unsecured creditor. And there are secured creditors who come in front of you. And derivatives are one of those. And you put your finger right on the thing that makes me mad, which is that a derivative is just a bet. How is it that a bet and a side bet and a set of related bets that banks make with each other largely are senior to the money that you put in as a depositor? That's just an astonishing thing, but it's skated right through our corrupt or venal congressional and Senate people. It got signed right into law by Obama, and it's just how the system has been working for a very long time, which is that the banks do whatever they need to do to protect themselves. But the fact that the banks specifically went and got an amendment passed, an act passed, so that they could have their derivative bets be senior to bank depositors was a really important moment, and people need to understand that.
Well, I think our audience understands it. I think your audience understands it. I just don't think most of our friends, neighbors, and colleagues understand it. And, you know, unless they're visiting Peak Prosperity, your website, or SGT Report, or Zero Hedge, or any of the other alt media sites out there upon which people can rely, people in this country are woefully underinformed, Chris, about what's going on. And it's, you know, we've been trying to sound the clarion call here forever about protecting yourself, right? How can people protect themselves once they're armed with this, frankly, scary information? How can people take steps and measures to protect themselves, their family, and any wealth, if they even have any at this point, from the banks that want to take it all from you? And in your latest book, Chris, Prosper, How to Prepare for the Future and Create a World Worth Inheriting, I would imagine you have some great ideas. I haven't read the book, full disclosure. I barely have time to keep up on the news every day as we try to post 70 to 100 current real news items at SGT Report on a daily basis, and I read all of those articles. I want to read your book, but give me the cliff notes. How can people prosper and protect themselves from this absolute storm, which is clearly coming?
Well, you know, all of my work is the same as yours, which is scanning the world and trying to make sense of it, and I put it all together into something called the Crash Course, and I know we've just talked about some very scary things like derivatives and whatnot. And so the first thing that happens when people get their heads around, really, the predicament that we're in is they say, well, what should I do, right? So Adam Taggart and I, for years, we've been running seminars, and we have people coming by the website, and we've visited people in our own lives, have been about becoming more resilient. And, you know, I can't predict what's going to happen in the future or when. We all have this collective sense of dread that, you know, someday something's going to happen. We don't know if it's going to be a big blow-up or a lot of little ones. But either way, I think that people need to have their eyes wide open and understand that we've been borrowing from all kinds of things. We've been borrowing from the natural world. We've been borrowing from the banking system. Rates that don't make any sense. We've overdrawn our accounts in a big way. And so we have to pay that back in some way, shape, or form. There's going to be disruptions. There's going to be an economic crisis, if not collapse, depending on how bad things get. So what do you do? Well, this is where the book Prosper comes in. And Adam and I looked around and said, hey, you know, it's not just about money, and it's not just about having some food stored, and it's not just about maybe having a little garden. Really, what's the framework here so that people can both be prepared as they possibly can for whatever might come, but also not be living in fear and not be hunkering down in some bunker waiting for really bad things to happen, but saying, what kind of things could you do today that will make your life better, happier, more secure, stable, maybe you're healthier, better relationships? If you have those things, will those help in the future? And the answer is yes. So what we've done is we followed a model that was put up by a couple permaculture guys, Ethan Roland and Gregory Landua, and there's 8 forms of capital that we think people should look at, because if you're rich in each of these 8 forms of capital, you will be not only insulated from what comes in the future compared to other people, but you're going to be much happier today. So we start with financial capital. We talk about that, absolutely. The next chapter after financial capital, though, is living capital. What do I mean by that? Well, living capital is all the things in the natural world that support us, right? Good soils, clean water, nice clean air, all that. It's also our own bodies. So if you were going to increase your living capital in your life, what would you do? Well, you would become healthier. You would take some of your financial capital and put it into understanding what your body needs. There's lots of tests we can take now. You'd put it into a gym membership. But you could also do what I've done and take your financial capital, and I've got a big garden, a vegetable garden. I've got an orchard. I've got chickens, bees. I am taking my 2-acre suburban plot and turning it into a relative oasis of abundance and healthy living capital.
Yeah.
And that's going to be really helpful to me on some future scenarios, but it's fantastically wonderful for me today because I really enjoy and get high quality of life feedback from all of my efforts at growing things and tending to things in the living world.
Yeah, I was going to say that. I mean, it's you get a spiritual benefit and a psychological benefit from being sort of working with the earth, working with your hands, growing something from nothing, and actually offering your family a sustainability and a source of food that is not dependent on the system or the grid. So that's a big part of it, too, is the psychological benefit, right?
Absolutely, and it feeds into a third form of capital, which is called social capital, which is not just how many people I know, but how well I know them and performing the actions with other people so that we begin to forge deeper relationships with each other. And so when I have, and I always do, excess abundance from my gardens and from my orchard and from my hives, I'm able to share that around in my neighborhood with other people.
Yeah.
It's really got a wonderful benefit to come and take the abundance I've created and share that with people. They're so appreciative, and it begins to form a deeper bond, and they learn something just in the act of me handing them something. They learn that I have bees, or that I grow things, or that I'm good at that. I mean, there's a lot of communication that happens with that, but it's very primal when people share the abundance they've created in their lives, whatever form that's in.
Well, I want to interrupt, too, and just ask you about that, because it seems to me that the powers that be have done a very good job over the years and want to do an even better job moving forward with Agenda 2030, UN Agenda 2030. They want to herd us into big cities, into small apartments. They want to destroy our sense of community. They want to destroy our sense of being one with nature. They want to destroy our ability to be self-sustaining. And there's definitely a counterculture movement against that that's growing. You know, naturalnews.com, Natural Remedies, Natural Solutions. There's everybody who is informed about the stuff that you're speaking about right now, Chris, wants to embrace what was once good. It will be good again, right? We took BGH out of the milk. There's an anti-Monsanto movement. There's an anti-vaccination movement because they want to do mandatory vaccinations. I'm just interrupting to support what you're saying because I think it's so important. People want to go back to what was good, but the people in charge of this planet, they want to continue to move us down this path of not having a sense of community, not having a sense of well-being, and being entirely dependent on the state. And that is the absolute antithesis of everything you and I stand for, isn't it?
It absolutely is. I can tell you right now, in my state, I live in Massachusetts, I could go out and buy some really nasty pesticide, herbicide toxins and just spray them to my heart's content all over my lawn, have them drift spray all over your lawn next to me. I could do it on a windy day and let it go all over your kids as they're playing outside. Nobody would be able to do or say anything. But I and my local farmer can be arrested for exchanging raw milk.
It's insanity.
Right?
Yeah.
How did we get there?
Well, yeah, I know that's a rhetorical question, but how did we get there? We got there because fascism rules the day, and these same criminals at the top of these criminal corporations have power within government, and there's this revolving door of fascism. And the people, again, we get back to this idea of pitchforks. The people need to grab their pitchforks. We have to take the power back. I'm saying that metaphorically, but there will come a time, Chris, where that is not a metaphor any longer. Zero Hedge just reported the other day, pitchfork time, elites have lost their healthy fear of the masses, end quote. I think that's true, and I don't understand it. What's it going to take for these elites to begin to understand how they've sold humanity out and humanity's waking up?
Well, it's going to take the same thing, Sean, that always does, which is they're going to have to be reminded. And, you know, I wrote, coincidentally, an article just a few days before that. I think that was a Financial Times article that Zero Hedge was referring to.
Yeah, that's
and
right, it was.
I titled mine, "Our Tone-Deaf Elites Risk the Ruin of Us All. And it starts with a John Kenneth Galbraith, the Harvard economist, starts with a quote of his, and he says, "People of privilege will always risk their complete destruction rather than surrender any material part of their advantage." Right? So that's really where we're at. It's just the echo chambers of the elites, they don't know any better. They're humans, right? So they only talk to their friends, and everybody's wealthy like them, and they don't get it. Because there's very little mingling. The stratification is almost complete. Some of these wealthy people will never spend a minute in the shoes of or understand somebody else's position. And we're all humans, right? And you touched on something hugely important. We're increasingly isolated, and we've cut ourselves off from nature. So we've cut ourselves off from the things that will remind us of what we really are. And the hubris can really develop when humans are cut off from anything that might give them that little bit of humility. And remember, listen, we're all born, we all die, we're organisms. We live by the rules that nature set down a long time ago. There's no avoiding that. And we've forgotten all that. So we'll remember. But people don't remember without a little bit of a wake-up call.
Yeah. Well, I want to just give you a nod, too, because you're one of the people that helped play a central role in my awakening. I want to call attention to your incredible video series on YouTube called Crash Course. Really phenomenally well done information. For those who are listening who haven't seen it, watch it. And for those who are listening who have seen it and still can't wake up their friends, neighbors, family, send them Crash Course. My God, buy the book for them and buy this new book too. Let's support Chris, because we have to support the truth tellers, Chris. I mean, that's one of the reasons I wanted to get you on to talk about your new book, because we have to support the people doing the real work, God's work, the truthful work, because we can listen to Anderson Cooper all day and understand the guy makes $10, $12, $14 million a year. You can listen to Wolf Blitzer. He's making $10 million a year. Diane Sawyer, pick your mockingbird. These people are all highly compensated to not dispense truth. And it's just my philosophy at this point that not only do we have to share truth, we have to support the truth tellers. So I just wanted to mention that. And the other thing I wanted to mention is, knowing that you're an oil guy, understanding your intellect as it pertains to oil commodities, I wanted to ask you about the price of oil. You know that I'm a big precious metals guy. I think you are as well. Physical silver, physical gold, a great way to protect your monetary sovereignty, a great way to get outside the system, a great way to possibly benefit when the dollar dies. What about oil? Because as I'm seeing oil in that 30, and it was for a while below $30 range, I'm seeing an opportunity, right? Because I'm trying to be objective, and I know that oil is not going to stay below 30 forever. I don't think it can possibly stay below 30 forever. And now I'm seeing Warren Buffett making a move into oil. Why don't you tell us about oil? And do you think that oil could potentially play a role in our listeners' financial health if they're able to buy any oil stocks, oil royalty trusts, anything like that? What's your take on oil?
Oh, big question. So it's a really important one, because, of course, you know, as goes oil, so goes the whole rest of the economy. Let's be totally clear. No oil, no economy. It couldn't be more obvious, and once you study it enough. So, oil's come way down in price. Certainly surprised me that it's come down this far. Of course, in a world of funny money where speculators have so much power and there's just so much liquidity flooding around, prices will not always give you the best indication of the actual value of something. And I think that's been true of precious metals, which you mentioned before. We'll get to that in a minute, I hope. But for oil, listen, if you're a patient investor, you could actually start buying in now. And don't go all in at once, but I think you could start legging in with large, very safe companies that are going to survive. I would not be trying to monkey around with any junior or mid shale operators at this point, because I think oil could go lower from here. It's at 32 right now as we're recording this, but It could go lower, and the reason is very fundamental. Cushing oil storage is almost full as we speak right now, and once that gets completely full, there's nowhere for it to go, but you can't just turn the oil spigots off. So what do you do with oil that came out of the ground and you have to sell? Well, you sell it at any price, and so that could be very price disruptive. But the other piece, Sean, is looking at China is now the largest oil importer. It's larger than the United States, and so they are the driver in this story. From a demand side, their diesel consumption was reported in December to be down 5.6% year over year. I think that speaks volumes about where their economy actually is, but sticking to oil for the moment, if China's oil demand goes down, there's plenty of supply right now that we would also see even more oversupply of the markets. The only thing that could fundamentally change this story right now would be if there was some deal with OPEC internally, or more likely between OPEC and Russia, if both of those actually cut production by a combined 1.5 million barrels per day or more, that could actually be very supportive for oil price. So that's part one. I think there's you know, barring some political sort of maneuvering between OPEC and Russia, I think oil is going to be oversupplied for quite a while. Because I'm looking at China's problems as just beginning, not ending, at this story. Yeah. So that's the first part. But second part of the story is, why would I say leg in now? Because over $1 trillion of oil projects have been shelved in the last year and a half, and we are 2-3 years down the line. When those projects are not coming online, we're going to discover that depletion is a very real thing, and that the decline of oil output from all that failed investment is going to be very serious. I would be looking for the world economy to be making another run after this recession I see coming. About that point in time, perfect storm. I see potentially, you know, very reduced quantities of oil running headlong into increased demand at that time. And then we'll begin part two of this oil story, which is an oil price that's too high for the world to afford, which is $100, by the way, and a price that's too low for oil companies to afford, which is anything below 60, by the way. So I'm looking at that floor and ceiling coming together over time, and it's going to get increasingly chaotic. Very hard for me to build a story that says, hey, stocks for the long haul. Just buy an index fund, 20 years, you'll be good. Can't make that argument without something really changing in the energy story.
Yeah, and I want to ask you about the Baltic Dry Index. One of the reasons I wanted to bring up oil is because it's tangible, right? You can't power your car with paper oil. God knows they'd like you to power your brokerage account with paper gold and paper silver. They're papering over everything, right? Everything is a papered over lie, the stock market. So I wanted to ask your opinion on physical gold and physical silver here as well. But before I do, the Baltic Dry Index, you know, I just mentioned that everything's papered over. The Baltic Dry Index is telling us a story that I don't think can be papered over. And the story is that the global economy is slowing to a crawl, Chris. And I think it's important to at least hit on this before we lose you, because, again, all of the information we get from CNBC and the Mockingbird mainstream media is essentially propaganda government talking points, right? And every now and then they'll have somebody on like yourself or Peter Schiff, but that's the rarity. Normally we're just going to get the Federal Reserve spin on what's going on. The Baltic Dry Index, though, is telling us a very, very important story. And I want your opinion on what that story is.
Well, it is. So the Baltic Dry is tracking those ships that are shipping what's called dry goods, right? So this would be iron ore, coal, grains, things like that. And so typically there's been a pretty good correlation between the price of what it costs to rent one of these ships for a day and the state of the world economy. There's a little muddying of that price signal right now because there was a huge overbuilding, and there's a lot of overcapacity in that industry right now. So it's more sensitive to these price dips when traffic goes down. But it's clearly saying that the tonnage traffic is lower than it used to be. And so it's, again, very hard to make a case that the world economy is growing or expanding or doing anything other than shrinking when the Baltic Dry Index is saying we've got way more ships and we have stuff moving around. And that's what the low price is telling us.
Right. And just to be clear, I mean, the Baltic Dry Index has hit a multi-decade low, has it not?
Oh, yes. It's everybody who's running at that quoted rate is losing money at this right now. But it's the same story we're seeing in the shale oil business. Like, well, do I continue to operate and lose money, or do I just shut down and really lose money? So they're choosing to bleed slowly rather than throw in the towel.
Yeah. You know, Chris, just a couple last things before we have to let you go. I mentioned physical gold and physical silver. We saw just over a week ago the London Silver Fix, the LBMA Silver Fix, essentially quote-unquote break. The powers that be in London set the price for silver, and I believe it was last Friday, they set the price for silver at somewhere in the neighborhood of $13.52. Meanwhile, in the real world, silver was still trading well above $14, around $14.28, something like that. The real world price did not respond to the silver fix, which in my memory is the first time that's ever happened, and or certainly it's the first time that's ever been reported. What did you make of that event? And what do you make of physical silver and physical gold moving forward?
Well, that silver fix fiasco was about as ugly as they come. And, of course, the press couldn't not talk about that fast enough, right? I've seen very little reporting on that outside of the normal silver and gold channels that you and I might inhabit. But, you know, and the reason that was so ugly is the silver fix is when a bunch of big physical owners come together. And, it's by the way, they're the five big they're the five big banks, you know,
yeah.
Scotia and all those guys, right?
JP Morgan.
So they get together and they're like, oh, yeah, we have a price. We have all the silver we want to sell. It makes no sense at all for them to accept 84 cents less per ounce in that market than they could also accomplish by just running over to the COMEX market and popping off a few futures that would be at the same rate. Now, there was a big decline in the futures market for silver that stuck for about 3 minutes or so and then bounced right back. So you're right, there was this big, giant breakdown disconnect between the forward market, which is that London fix, and the futures market, which is the COMEX side. And it's such a large, ugly fix, I don't get it, because any one of those players in that, they're so sophisticated, they easily could have avoided that amount of pain. So guess what? There was some skullduggery. I'm absolutely convinced that by driving that price down to that fixed amount, somebody really got shafted. Somebody who was holding the other side of those forward contracts, some big player, and they must just be spitting nails at this point. So that was, if you've seen The Big Short, you know what happened there. That was just banks scamming and screwing somebody. Happens all the time.
Yeah, but dude, let me flush that out with you, because again, your knowledge as a PhD is certainly something we value. So does it not speak to the overt manipulation? I mean, now, not even CNBC could cover that up, right? You've got these criminal banks, five or six criminal banks colluding to set the price, which now they're calling an electronic silver fix. But, you know, if it's electronic, that almost speaks to some sort of fair market mechanism. But of course, we know that's not true. Does the breakdown of that silver fix just over a week ago, does that not speak directly to the overt manipulation by these banks of the silver price and, by extension, the gold price?
Absolutely it does. And there's no doubt in my mind that silver has been the plaything of these big banks for a long time. And for whatever reason, they seem to make more money by hammering it than on the short side than hammering it on the long side. And in a fair market, you could say, okay, there's shenanigans. But the shenanigans should go both ways if it's at all free and fair, right? You know, sometimes you screw people on the way down, and sometimes you screw them on the way up. But that's not the case in silver. It's almost always subject to bear raids, meaning that you know, they hammer the bid and they just drive the price down. And somehow that serves them. I don't totally understand it, because eventually somebody should figure out how to beat them at that game and hand their heads to them, but that hasn't happened. So I'm sure there's some regulatory wink-wink lack of oversight that allows that sort of game to continue. But the other thing I take from it, Sean, is that when you see a big shenanigan like that fail, you are probably, and by fail I mean they got away with setting the fix at that stupid level, but it bounced back, and I'm looking at silver more than $1.30 above that fix level at this point at $14.86 right now. So I'd love to see those sorts of failures. It means there's a good chance that their shenanigans aren't working in the way that they need them to, and so this could all be reversing direction. So, you know, we're looking at gold right now up about $100 since the beginning of the year. It's above its 200-day moving average, good sign. Silver, same thing, up a lot, and they all technically look good, but from a fundamental standpoint, I don't understand how they can keep this game going a whole lot longer, given supply is way down, demand seems to be extremely robust, not just in the coin and bar market in the United States, but from India, China, et cetera. So I'm, you know, from both a fundamental and a technical standpoint, I like this, but what I'm really getting excited about as somebody who's been a believer that gold and silver are a preservation of wealth is that the raids that they've been, they, whoever they are, have been conducting I have not been sticking of late, and that's, to me, one of the best signs we could see.
Yeah, I completely agree. And ever since that silver fix broke more than a week ago, we have seen almost, I can't say unprecedented, but at least in recent history, we've seen almost unprecedented strength in the price of silver. It's been bouncing higher every single day since, and maybe it bodes well. Maybe finally these people, these criminal banks, have lost their ability to manipulate silver endlessly lower based on the fact that there is real-world demand, Chris. I mean, there's real-world demand for physical silver. We see it from the U.S. Mint every single year. They're selling more Silver Eagles every single year than they did the year before. The same is true with the Royal Canadian Mint. We're seeing a lot of demand at the SGE in China. There's real-world demand, and these monsters, these criminal banks can't cover it up with paper forever.
Well, if you want my last piece that tells me we're getting close, the SGE is no longer reporting withdrawals. And that, I don't know why they decided now was a good time to take what I thought was one of the best, greatest optics we have into real-world physical gold demand. You know, that's now gone, so gold is now back into complete opacity, complete shadowy territory in terms of really trying, you know, we think we can hint at stuff and we can read about refineries working triple shifts and all of that, but you know, now we're down to believing government import export statistics, which is just not my favorite. But I actually perversely take that as kind of like, ooh, China's decided they no longer want to provide insight into that. And every single year, we just watch that the SGE withdrawals just go up and up and up. In the last full year of reporting, which is 2015, SGE withdrawals alone almost equaled world mine output, which is due to fall this next year, by the way. So it's just somehow when they decide they no longer want to report on something, I know they're up to something, right? You know, like when the Federal Reserve, like, ah, we're not going to report M3 anymore. Who wants to know how much money is being created?
Yeah, you
know,
that's
like,
right.
Uh-oh.
Yeah, that's right. We can't let you have an audit of Fort Knox. Just live with that one we did back in the 50s. You just trust us on that. Those numbers are good.
Those are good. We looked at the seals. The seals looked good, so what else do we need to do?
Yeah, their lack of transparency is the evidence of their criminality. Hey, look, guys, as I mentioned earlier in the interview, I have not read Prosper yet, full disclosure, but obviously based on Chris's track record and his intellect, it's a book you're going to want to get. We've got some terrific quotes here I wanted to share with you. One from David Stockman, and here's one because, you know, I like Zero Hedge so much, and here's the quote. Clearly, our global addiction to debt-fueled growth will not end well. In Prosper, Martinson and Taggart provide a rare and much-needed resource for today's times, a comprehensive guide detailing the steps you should take now in advance of crisis to secure a bright future, end quote. Chris, can you tell people how to get the book so we can support your work?
Absolutely. You could come by peakprosperity.com. Of course, we have a nice little big box. You just click on that. That gets you to a book, and the ones we're selling through the site are signed. And if you like Amazon, which I do, you can go there. And at Amazon, in addition to the print book, you will also find an Audible book, which is my voice narrating, so I took the time to actually read the whole book out loud. And Kindle versions or electronic versions. So however you like to consume the book can be found there. And it's got really good advice in it. And it's a lot of people have been telling us that it's just the book they needed, not only for themselves, but to hand to other people as well who are maybe just on the edge of understanding that they need to be doing more right now.
Yeah, and guys, you know that Chris Martinson's website is peakprosperity.com. His last book was The Crash Course. And please support his work by getting the new book, Prosperity. Chris, it was just a real pleasure to have you on. Thank you so much for your time.
Sean, the pleasure's been all mine.
Well, the pleasure's all mine, Chris. And guys, thank you so much for supporting us at sgtreport.com, the corporate propaganda antidote, real news 24/7. Have an absolutely terrific week ahead and batten down the hatches. We're all in this mess together. God bless.